Hey, Adam here, and welcome back to the channel. Today I've got three odd disappearances that I've been writing about that I want to share with you. There wasn't really supposed to be a theme for this video, but I did realise by accident that all three of these individuals ended up missing their shoes. Well, one actually didn't have shoes to begin with, but I digress. So the disappearance that I'm going to start with, unfortunately there's not so much information on this one that comes in through like the press. However, someone very close to this disappearance got in touch with me fairly recently. Now I've promised this person secrecy, so I can't tell you who it is, so you're just going to have to trust me on this one. But all I will say is that this person was really close to this incident. Before we get into that though, the man in question is a Robin Dean Freeman. And the extent of the information you can find online about Robbie basically surmounts to this, and I quote, "Investigators are awaiting autopsy and identification results on a body found in Duffield on the 11th of July 2020. Scott County Sheriff Jeff Ed said Sunday that the decomposing body of a male was found in high grass along Boone Trail Road in the area of the Duffield Industrial Park. A motorist had parked nearby and noticed something odd before finding the body. A cause of passing was not obvious to the body's condition." So based on that information right from the get-go, it doesn't appear as though there was anything too odd about this. It's worth noting that as per the article, there was no obvious injury that would have resulted in Dean passing away. And a good question right off the bat might be, why was he in the long grass in the first place? What an odd place to be when you just so happen to pass away. The only real official update to this incident that I could find is as follows, and this comes from various press outlets, but we'll have a look specifically at the Herald Courier. The Scott County Sheriff's Office said 60-year-old Robin Dean Freeman of Coburn was found in a weeded area next to Boone Trail Road, near the town's industrial park. An autopsy performed at the medical examiner's office in Roanoke showed the passing was not suspicious in nature, according to the release. So my source explained to me that when found, the body had been decomposing for 5 days in summer heat, so there was a fair bit of decomposition present, as I'm sure you can imagine. Though from what I understand, in that state, a serious injury would still have been noticeable, and obviously the autopsy would then have revealed to what extent the damage was. But as said, it doesn't appear that they found a cause of passing at all, only revealing that it didn't appear suspicious and seemed to be of a natural origin. Now, I want to be careful about how I approach this next part. So, allegedly, according to my source, this person was a substance abuser. And I don't know the specifics of the rules anymore in regards to this on YouTube. I don't know if I'm allowed to name the substance, but it was heavy stuff, let's just put it that way. My source stated that Robin was previously in jail, and this happened on the very day of release, which is really odd. I'm going to quote my source directly. "There's nothing suspicious about someone like that passing away after being released from jail. After he was released from the Duffield Regional Jail, he was captured on a motion-activated frame-by-frame security camera at the Tempur-Medic mattress factory loading bay. He can be seen walking down the road with his orange jail shoes and socks on. He does not appear to be in any distress. When he gets to the edge of the screen, in between frames, he is gone. So it looks like he may have started running, though that's not actually clear as it doesn't appear that anyone else was around. My source also indicated that his body was found in the grass approximately 15 feet behind where he was last seen on the camera. My source also revealed that the grass was around waist height, and it's in an undeveloped field with a creek nearby. Now, this is a little detail that I found quite interesting, and I quote, "That area is heavily travelled by trucks coming in and out of the loading bay, and there would have been a terrible smell present after only a couple of days in that weather. But no one noticed him until several days after that. He was also missing his shoes and socks, which were never recovered." So I then asked this person if any conversations took place on the missing footwear, and I was told, "Yes, blank thought the missing shoes were odd. The investigators over the case assumed an animal took the shoes and socks." He also revealed, "There were no signs that an animal had gnawed on the feet to get the person's socks off, and the person who was first on scene searched that area with great detail after the investigators had cleared up and the socks and shoes were never found." Firstly, this just makes me wonder how many disappearances there's been where we've had, you know, bare bones information that are actually more odd than they seem, if only the details were actually reported properly. So, as my source said, If in very hot temperatures, and it's also a well-frequented area, I do believe that a smell would have been noticeable. That could indicate that it wasn't there the entire time. I suppose there's no real way to know that now. It could have just been that no one had gotten close enough. If foul play had occurred here, it's just bizarre that someone would hang onto a decomposing body and then place it in the grass. That doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me. Also, if it didn't appear that there was anyone nearby in the first place, why did he start running? If that's even what happened at all, it's just an assumption. But as said, he did seem to disappear from the CCTV as he was moving towards the edge of the frame. So that probably does mean, towards the end, he picked up pace for some reason. And again, this happened on the day of release from jail, and on the CCTV footage, just to be clear, he was wearing his shoes and socks. This one feels like a real puzzle, to be honest. I imagine that those investigating knew well enough that this man had allegedly been, and perhaps was still, a substance abuser, and they will have known of the particular substance as well. So it doesn't appear that the toxicology report came up with anything, and if he was taking those kinds of substances, you would have thought that that would have been the case. But what in the world happened to his shoes and socks? And it's really odd that they haven't been located in the time that's lapsed since. You know, we're talking July of 2020, just for those that are watching in the future. So there was one final piece of information that my source found odd. He said that around the body, the grass was pressed down flat and the area was quite large in comparison to the body. And it was in like a square-like shape. One hypothesis that was presented was that he may have been rolling around. Though my source actually showed skepticism at that, saying the area was just too big. He continued and said that if a sudden medical emergency had occurred, it's unlikely that he would have rolled around in an area big enough that would have pressed it down the way it was, because obviously it would have meant that he'd been doing it for a long time as well. It's also weird to me that Robin would just happen to venture into the long grass, somehow lose his shoes and socks, and then perhaps have a medical emergency and roll around in an area large enough and for long enough to cause it to press down. Is that not weird? I mean, I suppose confusion could have been onset for some reason that we're just not aware of, and then he made the decision to enter the grass, and then that was followed by some kind of medical emergency. I'm not really sure that explains everything though. If decomposing in hot weather, you know, even after a short while, it's gonna smell. There's just no two ways about that. And if the area is heavily frequented, then it does seem like it would have been expected for someone to, you know, have noticed sooner than they actually did. Again, the sudden emergency also doesn't explain the missing shoes and socks, nor does it explain, without a shadow of a doubt, the flattened grass. Now, I have seen this image, and I'm not allowed to share it. I'm not sure the precise size we're actually talking about, only that it was much larger than the body, and it did actually appear to be in a square-like shape. So it seems to me that either he'd been rolling around for a long while, or there was some sort of vehicle had been there. That seems doubtful though, because there would have been tire tracks, you know, leading to that spot. Perhaps it could have just been something else that was heavy, though, you know, you get into weird territory at that point, and frankly, I don't really know what that means. And yeah, it just quickly becomes bizarre, and you get into weird speculation territory, and, you know, you get to a point where you can't really provide any educated thoughts on the matter at all. So let's move on to just some final thoughts. And I quote, "I had spoken with blank. Without considering some kind of high strangeness, neither one of us can put all of the pieces of the puzzle together on this one. I don't think the body was there the entire time. After just a couple of days out in the heat, a human body smells terrible and there is no odour like it. If he had been there the entire time, I think someone who worked at the loading docks across the road would have smelled the odour of decay or saw the body from a shipping truck that drive by multiple times a day. When something doesn't make sense, we usually look to the most likely explanation because that is usually the correct answer. So I don't blame the investigators for not thinking something else may have happened. I may have thought the same if I hadn't looked into the missing 411 phenomenon." So that's all of the information and context that I'm aware of. I do believe that everything was shared truthfully and in good faith. Does anyone care to share their thoughts on this one? Was Robin just out of his mind or what? You know, I have no idea, but ultimately to me, it seems like we have a guy that was just released from prison. He disappeared from CCTV and then made his way into some long grass for absolutely no discernible reason at all, where he then proceeded to lose his socks and shoes and then he passed away without an obvious cause. What? Like, honestly, what even happened there? Anyway. Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot more that I can really add to this at this point, so let's move on to the next disappearance. So now we're going to talk about Dylan Ayler. Dylan was 3 years old when he disappeared from the town of Truro in Nova Scotia, which, for those that don't know, is located in Canada. Now, according to the Atlantic CTV News, the Truro Police Chief, Dave McNeil, stated that on the 6th of May 2020, Dylan had been playing with his grandmother outside of her home when he disappeared that afternoon. Dave stated that the grandmother had become distracted by her dog for just a moment and had turned her back to Dylan to sort the dog out. When she turned back again, Dylan was no longer there. So right off the bat then, whatever happened here happened pretty damn quickly. Dylan's grandfather, Norman Brown, told the press that Dylan is very active and loves to run. He said, "He thinks it's a game. Once he's out and about, he loves to run. He was outside with his grandmother and then he was just gone. It's the worst feeling in the world. I've never been helpless before in my life, but I am now." More specifically, Dylan was reported missing at approximately 20 minutes past 1 that afternoon, and officers arrived on scene within 4 minutes of the call being made. This was a really quick response by any measure, and those who arrived immediately began to collect evidence. They took a picture of Dylan and got his description, and then they started out in the search of the neighbourhood. Okay, so here's where things take a turn. So a canine unit was brought to the scene, and was reportedly able to track his scent, though not many details were made present about this. I'm not sure how far they were able to track Dylan, or if they lost his scent eventually, which I'm pretty sure they did because they didn't find him. In any case, as this was going on, the Colchester Ground Search and Rescue teams arrived, as did the Truro Fire Service, and finally, a National Resources helicopter joined too. So this quickly became a search on the land, air, and water because there was a brook and river close by to the grandmother's home. Dave stated, "There's a quick moving brook, Leper Brook, that runs parallel to Elizabeth Street. The water is very high and this time of year it's moving fairly quickly. Firefighters did go into the river, probably chest height, and they were searching the river. On the 7th, the day after Dylan had gone missing, search crews found one of his rubber boots in the Leper Brook at 20 minutes past 7 in the evening." This is obviously where the search was now concentrated, and they immediately had the helicopter flying overhead along with the ground components of the search, who intensively were scouring that area. The second boot was then located further down the brook, closer to where it meets the Salmon River, just before 9 p.m. It's worth clarifying, just for the sake of being specific, both of the boots were found inside the brook. So Dave said, "There was no sign of Dylan. Telling the family that we found his boots wasn't easy, but they're a strong family and they're coming to grips with any outcome that's possible. We're keeping positive. We're going to work as hard as we can to try to find Dylan." Underwater cameras, as well as thermal imaging technology, were used extensively over the entirety of that night, but they weren't finding anything of note. Early the following morning, they had divers in the water around both areas where the boots were found, and beyond that area too. The thinking was that it was possible that Dylan could have been carried by the water into the Cobequid Bay. I've probably butchered that, and I apologise if so, but there we are. So people began to question why the police didn't issue an Amber Alert, to which he said that the disappearance just didn't meet that criteria, and there was no evidence to suggest that a third party had been involved here. The Chronicle Herald gave an update with some information provided by law enforcement. This is what was said. "Unfortunately, at this point, the extensive efforts put forth by searchers have not yielded any new clues or information. In a consultation with the family, we are now moving from a search mode to a recovery mode." We got some more specific information too on the very moment of disappearance and the finding of the boots. Here's what Dave had to say. "As far as we know, her dog was involved. She might have turned around to tie her dog or do something with the dog. She turned around and he had left the area. Just that quick." One of Dylan's boots were discovered in the Leper Brook around 152 metres from the grandmother's house. So this was really quite nearby the initial disappearance. We do learn later that the grandmother stated that her time spent caring for the dog in that moment was no longer than a minute. Now, it actually depends on the source that you're reading, but most of them state that the grandmother had only turned away for a few seconds, while one stated that was less than a minute, which I suppose could still mean just a brief period of time. It's not actually clear what happened to Dylan though. Either it was his thought and that he just wandered away and made his way accidentally into the brook, or perhaps something not so innocent happened. In that moment, the grandmother wasn't looking. It's not actually clear what was wrong with the dog either. Obviously, there are no real facts about this that I know of, and it's just speculation because we simply don't know what took place. I can tell you that law enforcement were of the opinion that Dylan had made his way to the brook, where he then entered the water and had possibly been then taken to the Salmon River. It's also on the 8th where we learn that the search for Dylan shifted to a recovery operation following a discussion with the boy's family. Or rather, what we're now saying is that the worst was expected, and the hopes of finding Dylan in good condition had diminished to the point that it just wasn't a likely reality. So search crews returned to the scene and were obviously focused on the Salmon River, but unfortunately they just weren't finding anything at all. So I do think it's odd that this happened so quickly, by the way. It's hard to imagine turning around for a short time only to look back and the person that you're looking after is gone. Can you even imagine how that would feel? The thoughts that would run through your mind? God, you know, I hope none of us ever have to experience anything like that. Over the next few days, all of the reporting mostly just consisted of a regurgitation of the facts surrounding the disappearance. And, you know, just obviously in the hopes that someone would get in touch with more information. On the 12th, however, we learn that hope seemed to have been completely lost, and those heading the search provided a news release, which read, "It has been determined that the search area on land and in the water that has been so visible since Dylan went missing has been exhausted." So you can glean from that they were basically at a loss as to where Dylan ended up because they just couldn't find him. It's interesting to note that the search teams did get quite creative and they tried a new method. It was deemed that the tides were very similar to that of the 6th of May, you know, when Dylan initially disappeared. So they placed a mannequin of around the same size and weight to Dylan in the brook to see where it might have been taken. Unfortunately though, we don't seem to have any results as to how well this method worked. The team did say that it provided some useful information, but in the end it just didn't lead to Dylan's location or anything like that. Now, I'm always wary about adding things like this because I don't want to detract from the actual disappearance and I'm not going to dwell on it. If you want more info on this, you'll have to search for it on Google and you'll find it if you search for it. But it does look like there were some problems at home before the disappearance took place. It does appear that the parents did get into an altercation with each other a period of time beforehand. And I don't know how frequently these incidents took place or if it was just a one-off. But it is worth mentioning that, and it looks like the authorities did not believe that that was relevant to the disappearance at all. But I know that if I didn't mention that, then someone's going to be like, oh, nice one for leaving that out. You know, but as said, it doesn't look like it's relevant to the actual disappearance itself. So there were no real updates for a time, other than a repeat of the information that we know so far. You know, very little additions were provided, from what I can tell. But a month on, Dylan's mother stated that we're not going to stop until we find him. It's at this point I actually started to wonder if the parents thought that something else was going on, and it appears that they did. Here's what was reported on the 18th of June. "The boots don't make sense. The boots have never made sense. There were two boots that were near the water and they were found 6 or 7 hours after he disappeared. People covered that ground as soon as Dylan's grandmother screamed for help. As soon as the grandmother called for help, there was a guy instantly at that brook and there was nothing. No boots, no boy, nothing. Dylan's parents say they believe it's possible their son might have been taken and that his boots could have been thrown off the small railway bridge that passes over the Leper Brook, close to where it meets the Salmon River. They believe that police put all their attention into searching the river and perhaps not enough into entertaining other possible explanations for Dylan's disappearance. I will say that it does sound very odd that they had boots on the ground immediately at the brook, but there was no sign of Dylan's boots until later during the evening. You know, were they just overlooked or were they quite literally just not present at all? If they weren't present, then it's hard to know exactly what that means, other than perhaps Dylan was not yet present at the brook. But if that's right, then where was he? Was he wandering around for hours first before making his way to the brook? If so, then he was able to do it unnoticed somehow. You know, this is a populated area. Or did something else entirely happen here? I must admit that the boots not being present right away are throwing me off a bit here. I'd like to hear other people talk about this. You know, the boots didn't appear to be found right away, but 6 hours later, there they were. what? That really does sound like a bit of an irregularity here. So here's another quote from the father. They believe Dylan's disappearance was a freak accident. I don't believe that whatsoever. There's no evidence of anything other than boots. No footprints, no broken branches. Who's to say someone didn't throw the boots in there? So, you know, that appears to be where we are currently. The authorities don't suspect any third party involvement, and the parents, among others, actually, they believe that the finding of the boots provided some kind of irregularity. It's difficult to really know how to conclude here, because everything is basically speculation at this point. I could certainly see a curious 3-year-old tripping and, you know, falling in. But on the other hand, this happened extraordinarily quickly, and the boots weren't there when initially searched. You know, that was the point that Dylan's father seemed to have been making. And, you know, how often have we talked about that very aspect now on this channel? You know, the searchers go in, and they look, they find nothing. Then they go to that exact same spot a period of time afterwards and, you know, they find the boots, or they find a piece of clothing, or they find the person themselves, alive or otherwise. I feel like I've reported on that exact scenario countless times at this point. I gave this short shrift too, but it's not actually clear what the dog's problem was, only that the grandmother had to tend to him, or her, for a short moment. Was he barking at someone, or something? Was this just someone around that he didn't like? You know, again, that's total speculation, and I obviously don't know. But it could be an important factor. I'd quite like to see some discussion on the finding of the boots though, honestly. I've called it a potential irregularity a couple of times now. Is that just a bad take here? It could very well be, and I don't reckon that I know everything. What do you make of that? Was this just a very unfortunate accident? Or is it possible that something else could have taken place here? Anyway though, at this point, let's move on to the next disappearance that I've been writing about. And thankfully, this one has a better ending. Kenneth Neil Howard was 22 months old when he disappeared on the 13th of May 2019. And I've reported on a couple of odd disappearances from this area now. At the time, and I'm not sure about now, but Kenneth lived with his family in the rural McGoffin County, about 2 hours east of Lexington. WBIR News, or 10 News, they didn't actually share the specifics as to how Kenneth disappeared, but they did say that he was reported missing at 7:30 p.m. on the day in question. This is what they reported. Search crews are trying to find a missing toddler in eastern Kentucky. News outlets report 22-month-old Kenneth Howard was reported missing Saturday night by his family. McGoffin County Rescue Squad Chief Carter Conley says crews searched all night for the boy before taking a break Monday morning to regroup. He says search efforts will begin again in the late morning. Crews have been using a drone with thermal imaging technology to help with the search effort and plan to use dogs when efforts resume. A friend of the family stated, "I think the child got out the back door of the house. The way that house sits, you're looking down the road, so for the child to get down the road, his dad would have been able to see him." So WTVQ News, who pretty much have about the worst website I've ever seen, I just love how the video overlaps the text, there's just no way to get rid of it. Thankfully, I did manage to screenshot the page quickly before the video overlaps. Anyway, this is what was reported. Kenneth's mother said, "It's like he just disappeared, like he's just gone. He was outside with his dad, and we see that he just went around the back of the house, and when the dad went after him, he was just gone. I feel like I'm in a daze, like it's just a nightmare." Again, we have another situation in which the person disappeared awfully quickly. So Kenneth's playing with his father, he goes around to the back of the house and then just disappears. On the 14th, we get a little bit of confusion, and I'm sure you'll agree that this is always frustrating when things like this happen, because it starts to cast doubt. Although I can only imagine the kind of shock you're in when you realise that your child is missing, so I'm willing to cut the father some slack here, because you know. But WTVQ News report this. There are conflicting accounts of how the boy disappeared. Prater, a family friend, says he was told Howard's father was on his front porch talking to someone, and they think Howard probably went outside through the back door. ABC News reports Captain Carter Conley with the McGoffin County Refuge Squad says the boy's father told him that he was in the front yard with his son, then went back towards the home and when he turned around, the boy was gone. WTVQ then reported that search and rescue have involved infrared drones, ground teams, and dog teams. But you might have guessed it, the dogs did not find Kenneth's scent. Okay, so we have brilliant news on the 15th of May, because this is when Kenneth was found. So let's go through this. According to WBIR News, this is what was said. A frantic 4-day search in southeast Kentucky ended with success when a 22-month-old boy was found safe within half a mile of his home. A team with an expert tracker heard a faint cry in a trip pit area near the boy's home. They followed the sound and spotted Kenneth about 50 feet down an incline. Rescuers used ropes and a Stokes basket to safely reach the toddler and pull him to safety. After what appears to be almost 4 days lost and alone in the woods, he was likely hungry, dehydrated, but alert, conscious, and in good spirits. The boy wasn't far from his home, just about 1,750 feet in a straight line, according to rescuers. But the terrain was rough and rocky. Okay, here we go. Search crew said it really is amazing that he made it that far without serious injury. So, a boy that wasn't even 2 years old managed to navigate some seriously harsh terrain completely without injury, or worse, and didn't suffer from hypothermia, which was a very real concern at the time. Where have we heard this before? A child disappears without a trace, it happens quickly, and then the child manages to travel a decent distance into harsh terrain that surprises seasoned searchers and is then found without any injuries, nor suffering from hypothermia. And then there are just no questions asked about that. You know, let's just thank God and move on. You know, I mean, you should thank whoever you want to. I'm not saying that you shouldn't do that. But it's frustrating that curiosity just seems to fade in that very instant. You know, you get people that say, oh, thank God he was found. Anyway, let's move on. You know, that's exactly what happened here as well. No questions were asked at all. Thankfully, at this point at least, the Kentucky State Police told Lex that the case was not closed and remains under investigation. They didn't really clarify as to why this was the case, so I'm wondering if they were thinking that portions of this just sounded a bit off. You know, this toddler manages to find his way through harsh terrain and into a cliff area. Missing for 3 days, no injuries or hypothermia present. I'll bet there were some interesting conversations that took place, you know, behind the scenes. Lex18 then clarified that the area Kenneth was found was in a cliff area. On the same day, the 15th still, the Daily Mail reported that Captain Carter Conley stated this. Kenneth is being treated for dehydration, but is otherwise in remarkably good condition. They reported that Kenneth was found towards the bottom of a steep 50-foot hill, and here's an interesting quote. One official marvelled at the child's ability to make his way across the treacherous terrain and get as far as he did, calling him a true Kentucky mountain boy. William Petrie, who was a spokesman from the Kentucky State Police, stated that there was no evidence of foul play. And this seems to be because, as you might imagine, there was a lot of speculation going on about that being the case. So they had to make that statement. So let's move on to the 16th, where we get some more odd information. Here's what was reported by NBC News. Captain Carter Conley said, Kenneth was in the rescue helicopter, eyes wide, with what I'd say was a grin, just taking it all in. You would think a 22-month-old would be scared. This little cool gentleman was cool, calm, and collected. Rescuers described the area where Kenneth was found as mountainous, with rough terrain on the border with Floyd County. He survived about 67 hours in cold and rainy weather, wearing only a t-shirt and sweatpants, authorities said. Okay, so we've established that it's cold and raining, that he had no warm clothing nor shoes, and he didn't suffer from hypothermia. Are we going to see any questions about that? You probably guessed it again. Nope. Again, we have searchers saying that we only found him by the grace of God, and that's absolutely fine. But why is the curiosity disappearing right after that statement? Why are we saying, how did he survive this long, you know? How about, how did he get there? Are you certain that he could have done this alone? If it's likely that he was alone the entire time, why are searchers showing surprise about the distance he covered? And also, if alone, how did he manage to survive the temperatures along with the rain? I don't know what the temperatures specifically were, by the way, but all sources stated that it was cold and raining and that they were worried about hypothermia. And, you know, as I'm sure we all know by this point, when it's cold and it's raining, that is literally a recipe for hypothermia. Especially for the very young, like Kenneth. By the way, I'm not actually criticising anyone in particular here. I'm just glad that he was found, but I'd like to see a few questions being thrown around. Do you know what I mean? In situations like this, there are no stupid questions, you know? You should be asking all kinds of questions about it. We've highlighted this a few times now, and I know some of you guys in the comments have too. It's just like there's so much jubilation that I think these things quickly become unimportant and forgotten about. But I say that I think we should be talking about this. Okay, so still on the 15th, the Daily Mail provides some more information. Aside from being dehydrated, the young boy was in good condition and is now being treated in the hospital. It's unknown if he had anything to eat or drink during his time in the wilderness. When he went missing, he had nothing with him other than the sweatpants and the t-shirt that he was wearing. You know, this would be quite the implication if we begun to think that he'd eaten or drank something. A doctor also marvelled at Kenneth's condition. And it's also just important to note here that Kenneth wasn't actually found in the original search radius because they didn't think he could, you know, have travelled outside of half a mile from the starting location. They'd widened the area to about 1 mile, which to some extent demonstrates the surprise that was being shown. The Mirror reported that Kenneth was found on top of a flat and was basically clinging to the side of a cliff when found. And that's the way it was phrased here. And it sure does look steep. They state, his survival without food, warmth, and drink in an area frequented by bears and coyotes is being hailed as a miracle. Police confirm that he is in remarkably good condition. Authorities are still investigating what caused the boy's disappearance. I thought that was quite interesting indeed, just the way that that was phrased. Anyway, authorities are still investigating what caused the boy's disappearance. It makes it sound like they smell something fishy, you know, as if they're not completely convinced what happened here. But of course, you know, it should come to no surprise to anyone that I can't speak on behalf of the Kentucky police. That's just the way it was coming across, you know, as if they didn't believe they had the whole puzzle, you know, solved. You know, unfortunately though, that was the final press report that I could find on Kenneth's disappearance, and it doesn't look like we have much of a conclusion. This is going to vary from person to person, but I'm going to maintain that I'm having a difficult time believing that Kenneth made his way alone to that steep cliff and began to climb it. I find it hard to imagine how he managed to survive cold temperatures whilst it was raining in the clothes that he was wearing. He wasn't wearing a hat or shoes, you know, he had a thin t-shirt on with some sweatpants, and he came out of this literally unscathed. Does anyone want to have a go at reasoning that? Am I completely underestimating this boy that wasn't even 2 years old? I just find something particularly odd about these kinds of situations. I also find it very frustrating and annoying that after we, you know, we thank God, we have nothing more to say about it. You know, why aren't the journalists or the reporters asking any questions yet? I do find it confusing more than anything. You know, it's like, oh, thank God he was found, and that's miraculous. Anyway, here's the news at 5. You know, that's kind of what we're dealing with a lot of the time here. Anyway, that's me done with this one. Do leave your thoughts on anything and everything discussed in the comments below. I read every single comment, by the way. And while I can't reply to all of them, I do literally see every single one. So, you know, if you like the video, then give it a thumbs up. If you disliked it, give it a thumbs down. I don't mind either way. I'm just looking for your honest feedback. And other than that, I'd just like to thank you for watching. Hopefully you found it interesting. And I'd also just like to say a massive thank you to the patrons, as per usual, because you quite literally stopped me from having to do sponsorships that I hate and I don't want to shove down anyone's throat. Because honestly, I find them quite inappropriate for topics like this, so I just don't do them. So thank you very much to the patrons. But yeah, I hope that you've had a great day or evening, depending on where you are. And I'll see you next time. Peace.